Welcome to r/Reddit Revenge. This is a story of someone getting back. Welcome to r/Reddit Revenge. Welcome to r/Nuclear Revenge. It's a place for all forms of extreme revenge. Thank you, friends, for subscribing to the channel and for so many likes. Today's story is 1 in 20 years paying the bee back. Some time back, I was hired to a company by a CEO I had previously worked for someplace else. He was a good friend, so when his newest company wasn't achieving sales, he headhunted me to join the new one. The company hadn't made a sale in 2 years. Year one, the software product was in beta, so it wasn't ready to be sold. Year two, they realized using the tech staff to make high-end sales to C-level executives was the SH sales model one could conceptualize. In general, and there are exceptions, of course, these two personality styles don't speak the same language. Tech people talk tech, buyers talk benefits, and how the potential product fills needs. I bridge the gap well by translating tech speak into natural conversational language, so buyers better understand how their needs will be filled. The job was an hour and a half drive one way from my home, so the CEO said I could work from home, as long as I kept the sales management tool current. It's where you keep the notes of each prospect's status, came to important meetings, and made sure the executive team had daily sales reports. The first month I made the daily 3-hour commute, because I needed to have solid constant interaction with all the departments to rapidly form my sales strategy and develop a two-way confidence level with the section heads. Once I had a handle on things, I was ready to launch my sales plan. In the meantime, the CEO hired a VP of sales, B Boss, who started 4 days before I hit the ground running to get in front of buyers. She was a VP coming from the banking industry and had a long career in sales and marketing and finance products. I hated her from the moment she arrived. She knew F all about tech, and I spent huge time trying to orient her, which wasn't ideal, because I needed to work on my sales strategy. They brought her on board because she had strong experience gaining financial investors. Nevertheless, I forged ahead, traveled to a target state, and spent 19 days crisscrossing it. When I came back, I had 17 contracts from buyers, totaling about $2 million.
Does the vaccine committee consider the possibility that prisoners who have tested positive may now have some measure of immunity?
I wish that wasn't the case. I wish that we were able to identify people before they had been exposed to the disease in the numbers, but that also played a role in that conversation.
And Zink points out that prisoners over 65 are being offered the vaccine already. Diane Boyd's husband, who's at the hardest hit prison, Goose Creek, has so far avoided getting sick. He's 56, so he isn't eligible for the vaccine yet.
We said every day, worried sick to death whether or not they're going to survive this pandemic. That's excruciating.
Alaska health officials say the general prison population should begin to receive coronavirus vaccinations in mid-February. Once that happens, Boyd says, her husband's prison life will begin to return to normal. For NPR News, I'm Lex Trinan in Anchorage.
Ahead of Martin Luther King Day weekend, we hear from Clara Jean Esther. Clara was a 19-year-old college junior when she joined the sanitation strike in Memphis. She was there when Dr. King gave his final speech in 1968. She was also at the Lorraine Motel the next day, the day Dr. King was assassinated. At StoryCorps in Mobile, Alabama, she recalls the last days of Dr. King's life.
The church was packed, and finally Dr. King arrives, and he said, "When I enter into the city of Memphis, I was told about all of these threats, but none of that matters anymore because I've been to the mountaintop." And he proceeds in saying, "If I don't get there with you, I want you to know that we as a people will get to the promised land." I remember that night was a tornado watch, and in the background of that speech, you can hear the thunder and the lightning crashing. It was a powerful moment because he did his own eulogy. The next day, we pull up to the hotel, get out the car, and walking across the parking lot, I'm looking up at Dr. King leaning on the balcony, chatting with everybody down below. All of a sudden, what sounded like a truck backfiring goes off, and I can hear people saying, "Get down, get down." But I'm looking still at Dr. King being thrown back, and I take off and I run up the steps. And when I get up to where he's laying, I notice this pool of blood around his head. His eyes were open, and